ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਸਤਨਾਮ ਜੀ, ਵਾਹਿਗੁਰੂ ਜੀ ਸਤਨਾਮ ਜੀ। ਇੱਕ ਓਅੰਕਾਰ ਸਤਨਾਮ ਕਰਤਾ ਪੁਰਖ ਨਿਰਭਉ ਨਿਰਵੈਰ ਅਕਾਲ ਮੂਰਤਿ ਆਜੂਨੀ ਸੈਭੰ ਗੁਰਪ੍ਰਸਾਦਿ ਜਪ ਆਦਿ ਸਚ ਜੁਗਾਦਿ ਸਚ ਹੈ ਭੀ ਸਚ ਨਾਨਕ ਹੋਸੀ ਭੀ ਸਚ। ਤੁਮ ਦਾਤੇ ਠਾਕੁਰ ਪ੍ਰਤਪਾਲਕ ਨਾਇਕ ਖਸਮ ਹਮਾਰੇ ਨਿਮਖ ਨਿਮਖ ਤੁਮ ਹੀ ਪ੍ਰਤਪਾਲ ਹੋ ਹਮ ਬਾਰਿਕ ਤੁਮਰੇ ਧਾਰੇ। ਜਿਹਵਾ ਏਕ ਕਵਨ ਗੁਣ ਕਹੀਐ ਬੇਸੁਮਾਰ ਬੇਅੰਤ ਸੁਆਮੀ ਤੇਰੋ ਅੰਤ ਨਾ ਕਿਨਹੀ ਲਹੀਐ। ਤੇਰੇ ਕਵਨ ਕਵਨ ਗੁਣ ਕਹਿ ਕਹਿ ਗਾਵਾ ਤੂੰ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਗੁਣੀ ਨਿਧਾਨਾ ਤੁਮਰੀ ਮਹਿਮਾ ਵਰਨ ਨਾ ਸਾਕੋ ਤੂੰ ਠਾਕੁਰ ਊਚ ਭਗਵਾਨਾ। ਹਮਰੀ ਗਣਤ ਨਾ ਗਣੀਆ ਕਾਈ ਆਪਣਾ ਬਿਰਧ ਪਛਾਣ ਹਾਥ ਦੇ ਰਾਖੇ ਕਰ ਆਪਣੇ ਸਦਾ ਸਦਾ ਰੰਗ ਮਾਣ। ਧੰਨ ਧੰਨ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਗ੍ਰੰਥ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਜੀ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ has blessed us these few moments to discuss and to understand the greatness of certain Gursikhs who we can regard as the Lord of the Khalsa, the King of Kings. In history, in our Sikh history, we have many examples of great Gursikh people who have lived lives of honesty, purity, and the greatest lifestyle in terms of faith in Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj's teachings, taking inspiration from the true King of Kings, Satguru Sri Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. One of those great Gursikhs was a great Gursikh, a great noble Gursikh called Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji. The word Nawab means Lord. Similarly, like in today's day and time, we have Parliament in the UK. In Parliament, you have elected people who sit, people who represent our thoughts and our wishes and our questions, even. Above these MPs or these people who are elected by the common people, you have another chamber of elected people, sometimes selected people, called the Lords. They sit in what we call the House of Lords in the UK Parliament, for example. And Lords are usually chosen, A, because they have some prestige or some honour in society, or they've done something great. So on the basis of their status, they might be selected. Or they may be selected on the basis of what they've inherited. In both ways, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, when we look at his life, we can see that not only was he selected because of his status and because he had deserved and his actions and his nature demanded respect from the rest of the Khalsa Gursikhs, but also because he was a proud and a shining example of a true son of Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji was born in 1697. When we look at that year was almost 2 years before Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj called many thousands of Sikhs to Anandpur Sahib so that they could ask for 5 heads of Gursikhs and initiated the Khalsa. So when Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj did that, Kapoor Singh Ji was only 2 years old. In a lifespan spreading over 56 years, Kapoor Singh Ji became a shining example of what a Gursikh should be. And not only that, he had the qualities of being a true lord of the Khalsa. Kapoor Singh Ji's father's name was Daleep Singh Virk. When he was born, he had very long limbs. He was very tall in comparison with the other children. As he got older through childhood, he was known for his strong build. He was very intelligent and quickly picked up Shastra Vidya. He quickly picked up the knowledge of how to use weapons, how to use spears, how to ride horses. And he quickly developed the ability to learn Gurbani. One of the qualities that are missing in today's age is when a mother will actually sit with her child and recite Gurbani or recite some Simran whilst their child eats or whilst the child is playing with the mother, or when a mother returns home, when the child returns from school. As the mother's walking the child home, perhaps they miss that moment in reciting Gurbani or some Simran or a Shabd even that might have a massive effect on that child's life. When you look at our Sikh history, you find that many of the great warrior Gursikhs in Sikhi had very great Sikh mothers, and these mothers taught them Gurbani off by heart. So in the case of Kapoor Singh Ji, his mother was a Gurmukh, and she was his first teacher, his first guru, his very first enlightener. Because Gu means darkness and Ru means lightness. It means being enlightened. So the person who enlightened Kapoor Singh Ji about matters of the spiritual essence was his mother. And in those days, Gursikhs didn't have access to PDAs and handheld devices and mobile phones and Blackberries and Nokia phones. In those days, Gursikhs learnt Bani off by heart. And the reason why Gursikhs learnt off by heart, that term, the word learning something off by heart, your heart doesn't speak. What speaks is our tongue. The phrase itself, learning off by heart, means that something becomes so enshrined in within yourself that as your heart beats, you also do Simran at the same time. You also recite some Bani Tuk off by at the same time. So every single heartbeat doesn't miss a Bani quote or doesn't miss a chance. There's no opportunity lost in learning Gurbani. So a lot of Gursikhs in the past didn't rely on Pothia, on Gutke, on volumes of collected Bani. They actually learnt that and kept it close to their heart. Because in the past, and even now, some Gursikhs will say, "Ke Bani Gant Paise Gant," which means that if you've got Bani off by heart, if you recite it off by heart, then it's like having money in a purse. And just like you can go into the town and you can spend that money wherever you want because you saved it up, similarly, at any single second of the day, once you're walking to school or whether it's college or coming back from university or travelling in a car or a bus, you can recite that Bani at any second and you're accumulating the true wealth. Because Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj, the third Guru, gave a bachan. In Guru Granth Sahib Ji, it says, "Raag tana sri mahalla tija, eho tan akhut, na nikhutai na jaye, ਪੂਰਾ ਸਤਿਗੁਰ ਦੀਆ ਦਿਖਾਏ। ਇਹੋ ਧਨ ਅਖੁੱਟ ਮੀਨਸ ਦ ਸਪਿਰਿਚੁਅਲ ਵੈਲਥ ਬਾਏ ਰਿਸਾਈਟਿੰਗ ਗੁਰਬਾਣੀ ਆਫ ਪਾਹਾ ਬਾਏ ਡੂਇੰਗ ਸਿਮਰਨ ਬਾਏ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਟੂ ਸੰਗਤ ਐਂਡ ਸ਼ੇਅਰਿੰਗ ਯੂਰ ਵਿਊਜ਼ ਔਰ ਅੰਡਰਸਟੈਂਡਿੰਗ ਸਮਥਿੰਗ ਇਨ ਸੰਗਤ ਸੋ ਦੈਟ ਯੂ ਕੈਨ ਚੇਂਜ ਯੂਰ ਲਾਈਫ ਦੈਟ ਵੈਲਥ ਇਜ਼ ਇਨਐਗਜ਼ੌਸਟੇਬਲ ਇਟ ਨੈਵਰ ਗੈਟਸ ਐਗਜ਼ੌਸਟਿਡ ਨਾ ਨਿਖੁੱਟੇ ਨਾ ਜਾਏ ਇਟ ਕਾਂਟ ਬੀ ਐਗਜ਼ੌਸਟਿਡ ਕੈਨ ਨੈਵਰ ਬੀ ਲੋਸਟ ਪੂਰਾ ਸਤਿਗੁਰ ਦੀਆ ਦਿਖਾਏ ਦ ਟਰੂ ਗੁਰੂ ਹੈ ਸ਼ੋਅਨ ਮੀ ਦਿਸ ਦ ਟਰੂ ਪਰਫੈਕਟ ਗੁਰੂ ਸਤਿਗੁਰੂ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਗੁਰੂ ਅਮਰਦਾਸ ਜੀ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ ਇਹ ਸੈਨ ਧੰਨ ਧੰਨ ਗੁਰੂ ਅੰਗਦ ਦੇਵ ਜੀ ਮਹਾਰਾਜ ਹੈ ਸ਼ੋਅਨ ਮੀ ਦਿਸ ਦ ਟਰੂ ਵੈਲਥ ਕਾਂਟ ਬੀ ਐਗਜ਼ੌਸਟਿਡ ਦਿਸ ਟਰੂ ਵੈਲਥ ਆਫ ਰਿਸਾਈਟਿੰਗ ਸਿਮਰਨ ਐਂਡ ਬਾਣੀ ਕੈਨ ਨੈਵਰ ਬੀ ਵੇਸਟਿਡ ਵੈਨਐਵਰ ਵੀ ਰਿਸਾਈਟ ਬਾਣੀ ਆ ਆਰ ਹਾਊਸ ਆਰ ਆਰ ਹੋਮਸ ਔਰ ਵਾਕਿੰਗ ਇਨ ਦ ਸਟਰੀਟ Any single second of the day we recite Bani, we're adding profit, we're getting profit for it. Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj taught his son. Baba Mohan Ji and Baba Mori Ji were the sons of Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj. Baba Mori Ji, the youngest son, one day was watching Sangat bringing the flood of wealth to Guru Amar Das Ji and placing it in Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj's feet in offerings. He saw people bringing in gold, he saw people bringing in silver, he saw people putting paper notes, he saw people bringing in necklaces and all sorts of gifts for Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj. Some people were bringing food for the langar. Yet Baba Mori Ji thought in his mind for a second, Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj receives all this but never really accepts it, never really uses that wealth for himself or for his family. It's always ploughed back into the Sangat. It's always given back to the Sangat in some way, shape or form. As soon as he had that thought, Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj beckoned his son over. He stood with his hands placed together in front of Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj and Baba Mori Ji said, "Yes, father, why have you called me?" And Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj said, "I want you to get this money that's in my feet and pick it up and count it." And as he bent down to count it, he said, "Sat Vachan Maharaj, I follow your instructions. Whatever you say is true, I'll do it." He picked up the money in his hands and he started to count it. After some time of counting the money, Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj beckoned his son closer to him. He said, "Mori Ji, come closer." When Mori Ji stood again with his hands folded in front of Maharaj, "Haan Ji Maharaj, Ji Maharaj, Aap Ji ne bulaya, you called me Maharaj." Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj says, "Show me your hands." When Baba Mori Ji showed his hands to Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj, he said, "There's your answer. That is the reason why I don't use this Maya for myself, for my family, but it's ploughed back into the people who need it most. It's ploughed back into the task of establishing faith rather than using it for our own promotion and our own status." And then when Baba Moriji looked at his hand, he saw that by touching this Maya and the silver coins and the gold coins, and counting it all, his hands had gone black. The dust of the coins had gone onto his hands and turned them dark. And Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj said, "If by five minutes and 10 minutes of you counting that money has made your body black, what blackness must it put on your mind as you're counting it?" So the example that we were using was that the true wealth is the wealth of Gurbani, of Naam and Simran. And Kapoor Singh Ji's mother enshrined the Gurbani into his heart and made him recite it from a young age. As Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji grew older, he had a knack of playing with children in the area and forming armies and pretending to protect someone or attack someone. He used to have mock battles. And because he was very athletic and very strong and generally very quick with picking up things and picking up new games, He had the ability to marshal everyone else. He had the ability to get everyone into order and lead people from the start. And he was very brave as well. Once he was fighting with a friend with a mock sword, and his friend had a shield as well, the mock sword. And as they're fighting each other, one of the friends managed to hurt Kapoor Singh Ji on his shoulder. The blow of the sword went through his shoulder, up to his pectorals, up to his chest muscles, and blood started to seep from the wound. The greatness of Kapoor Singh Ji was that as soon as that happened, neither did he shed a tear and neither did he stop playing. He ignored the wound as if it didn't happen. And that is pretty amazing, to be able to do that at a young age, to not be stuck at bodily pain. Sometimes in our lifetime, we think, or we assume that our life is just this body. That we think that the parcel that we've got, this body that we've got, we eat, we nourish it, we exercise with it, we go to work with it, that is all we got. But Guruji explains to us that no, there is much more to it. There is much more to this body than we realize. Within this body, we have more bodies, we have a soul, we have an atma. But we never give nourishment to that. Those people who do give nourishment to that soul, they're the ones who are considered to be fortunate or wealthy in this world. Like Guru Amar Das Ji Maharaj says, Se tanvant har naam liv lai. Those people are wealthy, those people who are lucky, who have the name of the Lord as their focus. And Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji had that at that time. Therefore, he didn't assume pain when he received it. The next part, the important part of Kapoor Singh Ji's life was taking Amrit and being inspired to take Amrit. The year was 1721. Kapoor Singh Ji was aged 24 years old. And he had interest in spiritual matters, and he went to Harmandir Sahib, Sri Harmandir Sahib, in Amritsar Sahib. At that time, there was a very great Gursikh who was doing seva at the time of being the Granthi Singh. There's a point of contention here, a note of contention here. In the past, there were Granthi Singhs. Granthi Singhs are people who look after the seva of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. We might refer to them as Gyanis sometimes, but the correct term is Granthi. A lot of people don't respect Granthi Singhs nowadays. Yes, they should have high jeevans. They should have a very high form of living. And they shouldn't be under the pretenses of a committee. They should speak the truth. They should have high jeevans, high spiritual jeevans. In the past, there were people like that. Even if you were to call a Granthi Singh who didn't have much of a jeevan but did seva of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj to your home, and you gave them langar to eat, you did their seva, and that Granthi Singh turned around to you and said, what ardas do you want me to do, Bhai Sahib? And you said, Chardi Kala Vaste, then whatever the Granthi Singh did, because he does the seva of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj, no matter what or how he does that seva, that ardas will come true. So the person who was in charge at that time was a very great Gursikh, Shaheed Bhai Mani Singh Ji, who in the end was cut into 72 pieces and gave his whole body to Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj in seva. He was that kind of Gursikh. Bhai Mani Singh Ji was the same Bhai Mani Singh Ji who wrote Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj as Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj recited it at Sri Damdama Sahib. Bhai Mani Singh Ji was in the Panj Pyare when Kapoor Singh Ji took Amrit. He was one of the Singhs who was in the Panch Pyare, and that shows how much of a high jeevan the Pan Singh used to have at that time as well. Because whoever does that seva of being a Granthi Singh, whoever looks after the seva of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj, should have in their mind that they're going to be ready to give 72 pieces of their body up one day. That it should be with that in mind that they should do seva of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. Had that much respect and that much love for their Guru. The year was 1721, and 24-year-old Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji heard the Diwans of Bhai Mani Singh Ji at Harmandir Sahib, heard the Katha. Because today when we watch Harmandir Sahib on TV, we see that mainly it's always Kirtan that goes on in Harmandir Sahib in the centre. But at that time, up until possibly Maharaj Ranjit Singh's time, the Diwans of Katha and Kirtan used to be held in Harmandir Sahib. So Katha and Kirtan, Kirtan means the praise of the Lord sung by Ragi Singhs, and Katha is the narration of history or the meanings of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj, which are spoken and learnt. Kirtan is our mother and gives us Anand, gives us bliss and comfort. Katha gives us guidelines, is like our father, gives us guidelines to follow. So Bhai Mani Singh Ji was in the Panch Pyare when Kapoor Singh Ji took Amritand. He became known as Kapoor Singh. At that time, it was a very difficult time for the Sikhs because the Mughal government at that time was very much trying to get rid of Sikhi, trying to destroy it from its roots. But no one can destroy Sikhi ever because it is created by what a Gursikh would think is the light of Vaheguru themselves. Vaheguru themselves, Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj, created the Khalsa with the power of Vaheguru. Bhai Mani Singh Ji was one of the Panch Pyare, and Kapoor Singh Ji took Amrit and became Bhai Kapoor Singh Ji. When somebody takes Amrit, what does it do for you? In several years of experience of meeting Gursikhs, or even when you come to Sangat, you will hear stories of how when a person who didn't have any status in society took Amrit and suddenly they become so promoted in their status, they get something that they never realized they would ever have just by taking Amrit. You might get someone who had no confidence in the way they looked or their self-esteem was really low, but when they take Amrit, they become like lions. They become so proud of their faith, of the way they look. There was one Gursikh in the area where we used to live, and he would always think about taking Amrit. He would say, I really want to take it, but where I work, I deal with meat and I make sandwiches where I can't, you know, I have to handle meat, and I don't want to take Amrit because of that reason. Yet his mind was so hungry for it and he so wanted to take it, but his occupation had become a barrier for him to take Amrit. His singhani used to have something small, it's something very small at this moment, but when a person takes Amrit, it shows what power Amrit has. Has the power to give you the ability to walk on a path which is so narrow and so sharp, as sharp as a khanda, the blade of a khanda, and fine as hair. That's how narrow the road is that you walk down. But how much it gives you as a person as well. So where you have examples of Baba Deep Singh Ji and like Gursikhs who fought with their heads in their hands, you have also personal experiences in our own towns and our own cities. You just need to go to the Gurdwara and ask someone, how did you take Amrit? And you'll find an inspiration. That Singh who couldn't take Amrit because of his occupation, his wife wouldn't take Amrit because, well, she was really intent of taking Amrit. But in her life, she said, Bhai Sahib, I can't take Amrit because my Singh is not ready. And I want him to take Amrit with me. And then she related something as well. She said, just in passing, She said, I haven't passed my driving test. Had been nearly, she'd had almost 15 to 16 driving tests and she kept failing every single one of them. And she said, I just don't know what happens when I go to sit this test. This is an example of how small Maharaj can work, how big he works in all levels. The Sangat at that time said to him, you should take Amrit to the Singh and to the Singhani as well. And Maharaj will answer your questions. Why are you worried for? That is something so small for Maharaj. And by taking Amrit, you won't just get that result. You get loads of other things will happen which will sort your life out for you. After about a month or so, the Sangat in that town had darshan of that Gursikh and his wife again. The Singh walked into the Diwan, had a lovely dara, his dastar is beautifully tied, and on had a beautiful Siri Sahib around his neck, and with a beautiful gatra, a beautiful holster holding his gatra, his kirpan. And the Sangat felt happy, felt he's taken Amrit, excellent. And we went to walk and talk to the Singh afterwards, and we asked him, his Singhani came as well, and said, you took Amrit, that's amazing, that's excellent. Because when the Gursikh knew that another Gursikh has Amrit chak liya, they feel as if they feel blessed, they feel happy, they feel, wow, you're part of our family. You're our new brother or sister, you are our mother and father. Chaa hunda ya, you feel excited. And the Singh said, he goes, you know what? He goes, I just don't understand why I had hesitated for so long taking Amrit. He said, the day I took Amrit, the next day I went into work and his manager came to him and said, you've been working really well. We want you to stop working on the assembly line where you'll be handling meat. We want you to work in the admin office from now on. And that Gursikh just, as he was talking, he shed a tear as well. He's thinking, I'm such a fool that I didn't even take Amrit for so long. And to cap it off, the week of the Amrit, when the Singhani took Amrit as well, 2 days later she had a driving test and she passed in flying colours and not a single mistake on a piece of paper, the test paper. It shows, okay, it's something worldly, but Guruji has an ability to resolve all your tasks. That is a small task that Amrit resolves. The greatest task that Maharaj resolves for us is the safalta or the successfulness of our lifestyle, our jivan. Because Maharaj says that whoever takes Amrit, Maharaj is our protector after that. We don't need to worry about anything else. Amrit means not even worry about death. The year is 1726 and Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, or Kapoor Singh Ji as he is known at this time, reached the age of 29. Amongst the Khalsa forces, amongst the Khalsa Singhs, he was maintaining a reputation of being somebody who was well respected. He had a lot of honour because he could pick up so much knowledge and gyan of Sikhi. He had so much pyar for Gursikhs. He had so much love for other Gursikhs. And he was so inspirational that when he used to speak, when another Gursikh, a younger Gursikh, would come next to him, by him saying something, that Gursikh would feel as if they were encouraged to do more seva. He had that kind of effect on people. And he had a lot of respect for Gursikhs. In particular, Kapoor Singh Ji used to visit a Gursikh called Bhai Tara Singh Ji of Vahpind. His village was named Vah. Bhai Tara Singh Ji at that time also had another Gursikh. We know of that other Gursikh, Bhai Taru Singh Ji, who would rather have preferred to have scalped his head off rather than have his case cut. There were those kind of great Gursikhs at that time who would rather die for their guru rather than sacrifice their image as Sikhs. Something that we've got to develop in today's Sikhi. But Bhai Tara Singh Ji Vaan was another Gursikh. He wasn't Bhai Taru Singh Ji who did Shahidi by not having his case cut. He was Bhai Tara Singh Ji and he was a Brahmgyani saint. He was a Gursikh who used to serve other Gursikhs, in particular the Khalsa forces at that time. Any Gursikh who would come to his home, he'd made sure they had Prasada. He was such a beloved Gursikh. Bahut Prem Kardas. He had so much love for Gursikhs. Kapoor Singh Ji would visit by Tara Singh Jivan, be inspired by his ability to do seva. In 1726, the Mughals attacked Bhai Tara Singh Ji and killed him. Bhai Tara Singh Ji became a martyr. Just by doing the seva of other Gursikhs, the fact that he was giving support to other Jangi Gursikhs, other Gursikhs who were intent on fighting injustices. And his Shahidi, Bhai Tara Singh Ji's Vaan Shahidi, had a great effect on Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji. And he thought that time had come for him to join up with the Khalsa forces and bring about some revolution in the mindset of the Khalsa forces. So in 1726, after the Shahidi of Bhai Tara Singh Ji Vaan, the Gursikhs at that time, Bhai Mani Singh Ji Yadik, Kapoor Singh Ji, Baba Deep Singh Ji, Bhai Darbara Singh Ji, and a whole lot of these beautiful Gursikhs who had so much honour, who were true lords at that, true kings at that time, came together at Sri Darbar Sahib in what we call Sarbat Khalsa. Sarbat Khalsa was the most democratic way of getting a decision. The decision was always called a Gurmata. Five beloved Gursikhs, who everyone respected, would come together in the company of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj at Sri Akal Takht Sahib, Harmandir Sahib and Amritsar Sahib, and discuss what the next path was for the Khalsa, what they should agree on. And because of this attacking of this great Gursikh by Tara Singh Ji Vaan, the Shahidi of him, the Khalsa thought that something needed to be done to quell the cheekiness of these Mughals, to quell the fact that they've just killed such a great Gursikh and made him Shaheed. They thought it was important to regroup the Khalsa and reintroduce some aims. Kapoor Singh Ji was there at the time, and the Gursikhs who agreed, the rules that they agreed were that any Mughals who were bringing precious monies or bringing money for the government or tax being collected, because at that time, if you were a Muslim, you didn't need to pay any tax. But if you were a Hindu or a Sikh, you had to pay what they call jizya. It even exists to this day. Some Sikhs in Afghanistan or in Pakistan, the tribal areas of Pakistan, are required to pay a jizya, a tax, because they don't believe in Islam. But Gursikhi is against that thought set. If there's a rule for majority, then there should be the same rule for the minority and vice versa. So they said, we're not going to pay something that we don't have to pay. And they decided that time that any Mughals who had any monies or any precious metal or any transport that was transporting armories or arms for the Mughals, that the Khalsa would attack those conveys, bring that money and that armory down for the use of the Khalsa, and also to eliminate any Mughal informers amongst the Sikh people. That Sarbat Khalsa, regrouping the Khalsa and bringing the aims back, really gave some inspiration to the Khalsa forces and gave them some new energy. And they fought back against the Mughals at that time in many battles with great successes. To the extent that the new ruler of the Punjab at that time, whose name was Zakaria Khan, he thought that we need to appease this Khalsa in some way, shape or form. We need to do something that would encourage this Khalsa to stop fighting against us, because they just couldn't take the power of the Khalsa at that time. A Gursikh by the name of Bagail Singh went to meet Zakaria Khan in Lahore at that time. And Zakaria Khan gave him an incentive. There was a huge amount of money, a huge amount of land which they call Jagir, a small plume that used to be put on the head of a lord, what we call a kalgi. A beautiful shawl and pashmina shawl and various other important paraphernalia that a lord might wear. And he said to that Bagheel Singh that give this to somebody who you respect. Who you respect in the Khalsa. So Bagheel Singh travelled back to Harmandir Sahib. And at this time, Kapoor Singh Ji was doing seva at Harmandir Sahib. He was fanning the Sangat down. He was doing Jodiyandi seva. He was looking after the needs of the Sangat in the Langar. 1733 is the year. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji is 36 years old. He's fanning the Sangat in the congregation. By Bagheel Singh Ji comes back and it is another Sarbat Khalsa being called by the Gursikhs, a further attempt to solidify and keep the Khalsa together and give some more energy to it. And Bagheel Singh Ji placed the Nawabi, the lordship that he'd received from Zakaria Khan, and placed it in front of the Singhs. There were some great Singhs there at that time. Baba Deep Singh Ji, who was head later on of the Shahidi Misal. Baba Deep Singh Ji, the same Gursikh who alongside Bhai Mani Singh Ji provided the pens and the paper for the Sarup of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj to be written at the time of Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj at Damdama Sahib. Such a great Gursikh in Sikh history. Bhai Hari Singh Ji Hazuria, Bhai Buddha Singh Ji Sukar Chakia, who was the predecessors of Maharaja Ranjit Singh Ji. So all these great Gursikhs were there at this Sarbat Khalsa. The first thing the Khalsa did was give a tankha, what we call a punishment, to Bagheel Singh. Why did he go and plot and plan with Zakaria Khan? Why did he sit with them and even have the audacity to do that? Bagheel Singh Ji folded his hands and accepted the punishment from the Khalsa. But he now, at the same time, he said, but I've bought this lordship now. It's worth loads of money. There's loads of money attached to it. And there's a piece of land, a jagir, attached to it as well. Now, if it's come to the Khalsa, then should we accept it or not? Amongst the Singhs, the discussion started. All the beautiful Gursikhs, the great Gursikhs, like Baba Deep Singh Ji, Bhai Hari Singh Ji, discussing Sardar Jasa Singh Ji, Ram Gadiya, all these beautiful Gursikhs, discussed amongst themselves, and they came to a decision. It's true, this Nawabi, we didn't ask for it, but it's probably been blessed. Every single Gursikh is a Nawab, is a Lord. Every single Khalsa is Niyara, is unique from the rest of this world. The way we walk, the way we talk, what we wear, what we say is unique from the rest of this world. And the Khalsa said, we should accept it. But the next question arose, who should we give it to then? As they looked around, they saw the 36-year-old Kapoor Singh Ji doing seva of the Sangat. He was doing pakha to the Sangat. Nowadays in Gurdwara we have fans. We press a button and the fan starts and it cools the Sangat down. But in the past, a great seva was to give fan down the Sangat in the hot weather. And the Singhs looked upon Kapoor Singh Ji and they said, they remembered a pankti, they remembered a bachan from Guru Granth Sahib Ji. Mara says, Hasti sir jo ankus hai, ehran jo sir de. Mara says, just like an elephant, the guy who's sitting on the top has this sharp pointed weapon called ankus. And as he pokes the elephant on the elephant turns in the direction on the head. Wherever the head is being poked, that's the direction the elephant will take. Or, if you get a piece of metal, and you place the metal on an anvil, an ehran, and you smack the metal down, the metal will change shape, but the anvil will never change its shape. It remains solid. So Mara said, just like the elephant, gives his head for seva, poked by the button by the inspiration of Guruji. Ehran jo sir de, Maharaj said, just like the anvil doesn't is so solid and steadfast, it takes every button, it takes every commandment by the Guru. Man tan aage rakh ke. In that way, our mind and our body should be placed before Guruji. Our mind should be focused like the elephant gives its head to the ankus. And our body should become so solid. Aage rakh ke. Where should we put it? In front of who should we put it? Ubi save kare. Put it in front of Guruji. Ubi save kare. And do seva in such a way, in that way. So focused, so solidly do seva. And they saw Kapoor Singh Ji doing the seva. Eo gurmukh aap nivari hai. In this way, the gurmukhs, the guru words, give up their hankar, give up their ego. Sab raj srisht ka le, and they get the highest honor, they get the highest rule, they become kings themselves. And this is what was happening for Kapoor Singh at this time. When the Singhs looked around and they saw Kapoor Singh Ji doing seva in this way, they thought, there's no one better, there's no one more intelligent, there was no one more commanding respect at that time than Kapoor Singh Ji. And they beckoned him over. These Panj Singh stood in front of the, instead of Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj. And these Singhs were by Hari Singh Ji Hazuriya, Baba Deep Singh Ji, Sardar Jassa Singh Ramgadiya, Bhai Karam Singh Ji, and Bhai Buddha Singh Ji Sukar Chakiya. And they said to Kapoor Singh Ji, Aap Ji Nu E Hukum Ya, because wherever there's five Singhs, there's Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj at that time. The Maharaj Ne Beinti Kiti, these five Singhs said to Kapoor Singh Ji, that we're going to give you the Nawabi. You are going to be the Lord of the Khalsa because you have every quality. And Kapoor Singh Ji put his head low, put his hands together. He placed his head low and put his hands together. He grabbed his huzuriya and he said, Sat Bachan Ji, par aap ji samne beinti si. Because I accept this honor. It's a massive honor. I'm not capable of receiving this honor, but if you think I'm capable, then I must be. He accepted the Nawabi, the lordship. But he said, there's two conditions. I'll accept it on two conditions. The Jathedar of the Panj Singh said, what are the conditions, Kapoor Singh Ji? And he said the beinti was that we'll only accept it if you get this lordship that's come from by Bagel Singh from Lahore and place it on all the five Singh's feet. He goes, put the Nawabi, the lordship, on their feet, touch the feet of these Panj Singh that were standing before Guru Granth Sahib Ji, then I'll accept it. And the Singh smiled because that is the way to please Gursikhs, is when you get their happiness. Especially the Panj Singh in that form, when you get their happiness. That is such a high thing to suggest. If you compare it to the kings of today, you get an MP who gets elected in an Indian parliament or even the UK parliament. They come to your Gurdwara and they ask for your votes. But then you don't see them again until the next election. That is the state of affairs of today's lords or lord kings or kings, our local kings. So Kapoor Singh Ji said, I have another condition and another beinti. I won't say condition, but a beinti. He said, I accept this Nawabi only if it touches the feet of the five Singh. And the second condition is that, please, although you're going to bestow this honour on me of being a lord of the Khalsa or being a lord in the Khalsa, please do not take away the smaller sevavan from me. Please do not take me or starve me of the seva of the Sangat. Don't consider me to be a Nawab or a Lord and then not let me do seva of the Sangat, like fanning the Sangat down or jodian the seva or washing the pandey of the Singhs, because I can't live without that. That was the greatness of Kapoor Singh Ji. So much humility, but so much greatness all rolled into one. And that is something that we should adhere to. In our lives, if we receive any honour, we should always praise Guruji. It's Guruji's kirpa that I'm receiving this honour. It's Guruji's honour that I'm receiving this promotion at work. It's Guruji's kirpa that I'm getting married. It's Guruji's kirpa I'm getting the extra prayer eyes. It's Guruji's kirpa I'm buying a new car. Everything should be praised in front of Guruji because he is the one who gives us everything. When the Singhs heard that Jakare went off, the Singhs placed the Kalgi, the lordship, on their feet, and then they placed it over. They tied this beautiful shawl onto Nawab Kapoor Singh that had arrived from Lahore. And amongst the Jakare and the Sangat, Kapoor Singh Ji was blessed a Nawabi. He became Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji. So what did Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji do as the Nawab, as the a lord in the Khalsa? The first thing that Kapoor Singh Ji did was confer with his rest of his Khalsa colleagues about what they should do about the Khalsa now. With the help of Darbara Singh Ji and Baba Deep Singh Ji and all the other beautiful Gursikhs and renowned Gursikhs, they formed what we call the Dal Khalsa. The Khalsa was split up into two. Anyone over the age of 40 became known as the Buddha Dal. And anyone under the age of 40 became known as Tarna Dal. The objectives of these two Dal, Dal means army or battalion. The aim of these battalions were that anyone over the age of 40 would be focused more on prachar of Amrit. In Sikhi, and this is something that Naujawan and youth or people who are coming into Gurdwara committee should think about, that the Khalsa grows through Amrit Sanchars. If we focus on Amrit Sanchar and Amrit Prachar at this moment, more and more people will come into Sikhi. And as the Khalsa will grow, then more spirituality will grow as well. More kirpa, more blessings will happen. So the Buddha Dal was aim was to go around and talk about Sikhi and do prachar of Sikhi. Spread the word of Amritaris and spread the Khalsa faith. The Tarna Dal, who was under 40, was the more of a younger force, and they were a fighter force. Out of the two Dals, the two battalions, the Tarna Dal grew amazingly because we had Gursikhs with the foresight of what to do with the Khalsa. And there are Gursikhs like that today as well who share that foresight, who have that foresight about taking the Khalsa path forward. But one word of note is their jeevans should be really high, their lifestyle will be really high. The amount of bani they recite will be really high, like Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji's was. The Tarna Dal grew very quickly. Up to 12,000 Gursikhs quickly joined the Tarna Dal, the fighting force of the Khalsa. As it grows so much, there were certain rules that were enforced amongst the two Dals to make sure Pyar and Prem existed. One of them was that whenever the occasion happened, whenever it occurred, that the Khalsa, Buddha Dal and Tarna Dal members should meet together and share langar together. And in some places, the food was prepared under the same battalions, but shared amongst Buddha and Tarna Dal together. So as the Tarna Dal grew very large, again, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji had to think about, with the rest of the Gursikhs, had to think about how to reorganize the Khalsa Dal, the Tarna Dal. So out of that 12,000 group of people, with the help of his foresight and his focus, they created what we call the missiles, the Sikh missiles. 12 or 12 missile groups were created. Each group of missiles out of those 12,000 had their own Nishan Sahib, their own flag, and their own Nagara, their own war drum. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji became a leader of what they call the Singapuriya missile. The Shahida missile was run by Baba Deep Singh Ji. Baba Buddha Ji became the leader of the Sukar Chakya missile, and so on. Jasar Singh Ji Ramgadiya became leader of the Ramgadiya missile. So the common aim was that we're going to exist in the Khalsa form, and we're going to carry on the Rani, the Bani, the Sani, the Kani, the way we live, the way we talk, the way we speak. Everything was the Khalsa way. That was common to the Khalsa. And the aim was to make sure that these Mughals who were ruling the country didn't get a say in their injustices. When the Zakaria Khan realized what Nawab Kapoor Singh had done, his action of trying to appease the Khalsa wasn't going to work. Zakaria Khan got tough himself. He got 4,000 soldiers, Mughal soldiers, and split them into 8 different battalions, 8 different parts, and they combed the country. And basically, the rule that they gave was find a Sikh and kill him. Let's look a bit closely at what the rules were. If a head of a Sikh was bought on the end of a spear, Zakaria Khan would give 50 rupees for that head. Je ek Sikh junda vi lab jave, get 50 rupees for that as well. If somebody had news of where a Sikh was living, you'd get 10 rupees for that. If you captured and handed over a Sikh, you'd get 15 rupees reward. If you looted a Sikh's house, no problem. We didn't see it happen. Whereas the state was supposed to protect everyone in it, but Sikhs were being marginalized, and also some form of genocide was being created. Look after a Sikh at night in your house or your fields, the penalty was death straight away, like happened to by Tara Singh Diwan. If whereabouts of Sikhs are known and no one is handed in, you would receive death for it. If anyone gave food to a Sikh or even helped a Sikh, the unu musalman banaya janda. If a rich government official helped a Sikh, he would lose his job. These kind of policies were put into action by Zakaria Khan because he realized that he wanted to uproot these Gursikhs, these people who are standing up against injustices, standing them against the despotic rule, one rule for another and another for another. Zakaria Khan put these into action. And he had governors in different areas who were following it, who were pursuing it, pursuing these rules. Look at what the Gursikhs endured at that time. These kind of policies, having the fear of even looking like Guru Gobind Singh Ji, having the image of a Gursikh, was considered lethal for the government. And if we think that this was just recently, you just need to look at 1984, the period leading up to 1984. In 1982, the government did the same thing. If you were a Gursikh, if you were a Sikh, you weren't allowed entry into the Asiad Olympic Games in 1982. And the rest of the people didn't get searched, but if you were a Gursikh, you had to be searched and stripped and checked if you had any weapons on you. Even to this day, discrimination happens against a Gursikh. If you wear a kirpan, you can't work in the airport in India, in Amritsar Sahib, to this day. So although governments changed, the policies are quite similar. Gursikh's hair gets cut, there's no inquiry. There's no interest of why a Gursikh young person might get killed. There's still almost 3,000 young Sikh youth who just disappeared in the period from the early 1990s. And to this day, not a single case has been registered against anyone. To this day, no one has been caught for the November genocide that occurred in Delhi. To this day, some people are still walking around free, like Kamal Nath and Sajjan Kumar and so forth. So, it makes you think about what the Khalsa was doing at that time. Did they give up their Sikhi? No. In the midst of all that corruption, in the midst of all that stress, and all that worry about having a death penalty on your head, there were Gursikhs who kept the Swarup of Sikhi, and they kept to it so fiercely and proudly, of which Kapoor Singh Ji, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, was one. And also at that time, there were people who were prepared to serve Gursikhs, and they were all different faiths. They were Muslim, they were Hindu, who had great love for Gursikhs, who had great love for the character of Amrita Hari Khalsa Gursikh at that time. When Nader Shah came from Afghanistan to see what was going on in Punjab and why Zakaria Khan was having difficulty with these people, these small minority of people, he asked him, why can't we get victory over the Sikhs?
And he asked the Subedar of Lahore. And this is what he said. He said, "Tell me, who are these Sikhs?" And the Subedar answered, "This is a group of hermits. They believe in bathing twice in the sacred lake of their Guru and they become invisible," which is a reference to Harmandir Sahib. "Where they disappear, no one can make it out." Nader Shah became curious. He asked again, "Where do they live?" And the answer was, "Their homes are saddles of their horses." This aroused more curiosity in Nader Shah. He asked again, "What do they eat then?" "They eat grams as if they are fried almonds. They eat sholay, little sholay chickpeas as they are almonds." All the answers bewildered Nader Shah. And after contemplating for some time, Nader Shah said, "Beware of these people, because these courageous people are the ones who are going to rule far and wide. They will conquer this whole country." And that's exactly what happened. In a way, it was a prophecy, because Maharaja Ranjit Singh controlled the whole of Afghanistan right to Punjab, the borders of Nepal and Tibet, was under the rule of Khalsa, not long after Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, the era of the King of the Kings. So what other hard times were going on at this time for Gursikhs? Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, by this time, was a jathedar of almost 800 Singhs. They were being served, they were looking after, they joined up with another general at that time whose name is Baba Ala Singh Ji. And together they initiated Prachar in the Bathinda area, in the Damdama Sahib area of Punjab. But at this time, the kind of tortures that Gursikhs were going through were heard. Gursikhs were here, what was going on. You see pictures of Gursikhs being put onto spiked wheels, what we call Chadkriya, by Subir Singh Ji, by Sarbaz Singh Ji, father and son were put onto these wheels, and beyond other, countless other Gursikhs were made shaheed like that, buried in the ground and having their heads shot. Babies were killed in front of their mothers, chucked into the air and pierced onto the end of spears. The Gursikhs' eyes were gouged out. Some Gursikhs are drowned in the river Ravi. Some Gursikhs had their legs tied to horses and dragged around. Some were tied to elephants. Their arms and their legs were tied to elephants at both ends and then stretched. The elephants were marched into the north and to the south direction, stretching and ripping the Gursikhs apart. Gursikhs were hung from trees and lynched. Hands and legs were chopped off. These are the kind of tortures that Gursikhs were going through at that time. And it had a massive disheartening effect on the rest of Gursikhs as well. So Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji and Baba Ala Singh Ji and the other Gursikhs thought, "What do we need to do to inspire the Khalsa again, to re-energize the Khalsa?" Because that's what a true leader, a true lord does. Re-inspire the Khalsa at the most, the time that they're most down. And even if we look at our lives, when we are most down, we might turn to drink, we might turn to alcohol, we might turn to the most silliest things. But the biggest answer lies within ourselves. The Naam is within ourselves, but we just can't see it. It's like, if you want water, you have to bore down into the... In the past, people used to bore down into the ground, send a massive drill right into the ground, and when they hit the fountain of water, the water would gush up to the top. Similarly, you might meet a Gursikh who might help bore down within you and make you understand one day that the Simran is within us. We need to bore down into it, and then the Simran will come out, and our life will change and transform, and all the dukkha and the unhappiness we have in our lives, and the things not going right for us, not getting married, not getting a job, not getting home, all these things will get resolved because we don't look within ourselves. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji thought of another way of re-energizing the Khalsa, and it became the start of what we call the Khalsa Bole, or the Khalsa language was developed. It was re-energized with a system of code words, which not only gave optimism to the Khalsa, but also confused the enemy. Nearly 900 words were recreated. Some of the words, for example, if there's one Singh walking down the road or down the path, he would refer to be as Sava Lakh. He wasn't one Singh. He was 125,000, because that's what Guruji said. Guru Gobind Singh Maharaj said, "Sava lakh se ek ladaun, tabai Gobind Singh naam kahaun." One of my Gursikhs will fight 125,000. A banduk was called a Ramchanga. A talwar became known as the Siri Sahib. Zakriya Khan became known as Khannu. surveillance things, people who used to do spy on the things and on the Mughals and look at information for battles were called Tangu. Okay, it became known as Panjava. Because some of these words come from Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj as well. Chilies became known as Ladakia, salt became known as Sarbras. There was beyond the names. If I explained all these words now, it wouldn't be cold words. But the Khalsa would use these. Parshada became a word for roti. And sometimes, even, you know, there's a quote sometimes that ek mota choleyan di kha ke tere langaran cho. Sava sava lakhnu daraye tera khalsa. Gursikhs used to just have, because they were in such extreme conditions, living in the jungles, and the Zakaria Khan's laws were being followed, and people were being handed in and killed left, right, and center, and tortured. Gursikhs were being tortured in the what we mentioned before. It was such a difficult time. Makes us think, so what pressures have we got today? If Gursikhs were being tortured at that time and had to resort to cold language, is there somebody holding a gun to our head today for being a Gursikh? No. We can so easily keep the roop of a Gursikh today, but we don't understand what our history is. When we look at our history, you will realize what a compendium, what a kaleidoscope of emotions and pride it is. And you will rediscover that pride by looking at our own history. So these words that the Khalsa introduced used to confuse the Mughals. Rupees were called Shillad. A blind Singh was called a Surma Singh. So even people who didn't have much confidence, if there was a Singh who was, for example, crippled because he might have been damaged by war, he became not a crippled Singh, but a Suchalla Singh, somebody who walks beautifully. Suchalla. And these words re-energized the Khalsa. Not only that, but with the leadership of Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji and the other Gursikhs at that time, they did carry out loads of little emergency situations or excavations of Gursikhs. If there were Gursikhs stuck in jails, they would go at midnight into the prison of Lahore and take all the Gursikhs out in front of the governors. Hold guns to the Mughals' head and say, what are you going to do? Because we're the Khalsa. You don't know who we are. And they would take the whole Gursikhs and have no fear of their lives. They used to play with their lives. Ghazi Abdul Rahman at that time, who was Subedar of Lahore at that time, and Amritsar Sahib came to that area, said, if any Gursikh comes to do Ishnan, I'm not going to let anyone come and do Ishnan at Harmandir Sahib. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji then instructed Singhs from his Jatha that every day two Gursikhs will go and have Ishnan at Harmandir Sahib. Every day. And that's what they did. And that's why that Subedar said that they go to Harmandir Sahib Ishnan and we can't see them. They become invisible. Because that is the Shakti that Maharaj blessed them. At that time when Harmandir Sahib was being desecrated, people by Mancha Singh Ji would swim through the Sarovar and put the Jyot in Harmandir Sahib and come back out. And he got his Shahidi being shot by bullets in the Sarovar by Mancha Singh Ji. There's so many heroic tales of these Gursikhs by Tharaj Singh Ji, by Sukha Singh Ji, by Mehtab Singh Ji would go and chop off the head of Masal Rangad. All these kind of Gursikhs who were desecrating Harmandir Sahib. Because Harmandir Sahib is more dear to us than our own heart. When Guru Arjan Dev Ji Maharaj placed the foundation stone of Harmandir Sahib, some people say it was Sai Mia Mir Ji. There's only one person in our Sikh history that says Sai Mia Mir Ji, and that was Gyani Gyan Singh Ji. He was a great Sikh author and philosopher. But in accordance with Guru Granth Sahib Ji's Bani and the words of great spiritual souls in Sikhi, it was Guru Arjan Dev Ji Maharaj who placed the foundation stone of the Harmandir Sahib. But as he placed it, one of the karmcharis at that time, one of the person who was doing seva, he moved the brick. And as he moved the brick, Guru Arjan Dev Ji Maharaj asked him, he said, why have you moved the brick for? You should have left it as it was. And he asked for forgiveness, and Maharaj said, now you moved it, this place will be rebuilt again. It will be destroyed and rebuilt again. And it did happen during these times. It shows the words of Guru Arjan Dev Ji Maharaj are so powerful. In 1734, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji avenged the Shaheedi of Bhai Mani Singh Ji by killing Samund Khan and Zakaria Khan. There's one incident when Zakaria Khan realized that his life was coming to an end because he had done so much pop. He had killed so much Gursikhs. Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji made a plan that we're going to go to the Badshahi Mosque where Zakaria Khan would come to do his prayers and kill him there in front of his people. He was so brave, almost 30 to 40 Gursikh Singhs and Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji disguised themselves as Musliman Peer. Sareyan ne hare kapde paale, kes piche nu sitte de, put their hair back, peeran de kapde paale. And as they got into the main Badshahi Mosque, they waited in turn for Zakaria Khan, who luckily for himself didn't turn up that day. And they went in, and when they went in, the rest of the Muslims said to them, said, why aren't you praying with us? Tusi peeran. And they said, we're the peers of the peeran da peer. Jira peeran da peer ya Guru Gobind Singh Ji. We're his peer. We're his Gursikhs. We're his Khalsa. They told the Mughals that we came here to get Zakaria Khan. They weren't afraid. They were so brave and so proud of who they were and had so much. In Punjabi, we call it so much spirit. Is the only word we could say in English. So much jajba in Punjabi is the word. So much motivation to live like a Gursikh and be proud of who they were. In 1753, just shortly after the Chota Kalugara, 8,000 Sikhs were mercilessly killed at that time. 1753, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji breathed his last. Baba Atal Rai Gurdwara in Amritsar Sahib is their samad to this day. But Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji said in his last words, he said that every Gursikh should follow the words and bachans and instructions of Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj and be a proud warrior. They placed the Nawabi in front of the feet of another great Sikh general whose name was Sardar Jassa Singh Ji Aluwalia. He became the next Lord of the Khalsa. But this great general, Nawab Kapoor Singh Ji, who in his life spent so much to all his life reforming the Khalsa, thinking Khalsa thoughts, reorganizing, having vision. And this is something that's missing today. This is the appeal to all the Nawjawan who are listening, that we need a vision today for our Khalsa. We need to refocus on the greatness of Amrit in our lives. We need to have an exemplary Gursikh jeevan, because that's what Nawab Kapoor Singh said. Every Gursikh leave a role model life. Be great Gursikhs. Follow the rehat, the discipline of Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj. And this great Nawab, who was so humble, who showed so much love for other Gursikhs, who only accepted that Nawabi, the lordship, by placing it in the feet of Khalsa first. That's a great lesson for us today. That whenever we have honour, we place that honour in the feet of Gursikhs first, or in the feet of Guru Granth Sahib Ji, Guru Gobind Singh Ji Maharaj first. He never even forgot simple seva, even when he was such a great leader. And that's what we need today. Great Gursikhs with humility, but great vision. Bhulna chukani maafi. Please forgive countless mistakes. But we can dream, and we can have that dream, and we can put that dream to practice of being great Gursikhs ourselves. But give total, total praise to Guru Granth Sahib Ji Maharaj for the ability to do that and the power to do that. Please forgive mistakes. Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Vaheguru Ji Ki Fateh.